Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Star Wars New Canon Book Club. We're on The Mandalorian, Episode 3. Davis, Alex, Jesse, enough introductions. Let's jump in. I'm really excited to talk about this,
this
one.
This is the way.
This is the way. Although, the way seems mighty convenient.
I have a few questions about the way, but we'll get there.
Nope. No questions.
I got way questions. But
remember what happens when you ask questions, okay? You make ex-Imperial people real angry. Real short.
That's true. He got really snippy. Like personally offended.
Yeah.
He was like, "How could you say that to me?
I thought we had a good thing going."
It was heartbreaking when you said that.
That baby Yoda.
That baby Yoda.
Oh.
I only saw it on the set.
It was heartbreaking.
That's
I know.
Best video.
I know exactly what he means. It crushes me every moment I see that perfect little creature.
God bless it. This episode was so much meatier than the previous episode, where I really enjoyed the last episode because of its sort of like terse, sort of like long, sort of patient action sequences and kind of like aesthetic stuff. This one was like kind of the opposite. It was a lot more meaty, a lot more character stuff.
I think last time we said, oh, this is what's going to happen. He's going to take the baby back. He's going to get the Beskar. I just thought that was going to be the end of the season. I didn't know we were going to get it this episode, and it would wrap up this arc.
We only have a few episodes left, you know what I mean?
I guess you're right. That's why I assumed that would be the end of the season, but they wrapped this up real quick. So my imagination leads me to believe that maybe the rest of the season is the Imperials after him, and he's trying to, like, dodge them. Maybe, I don't know.
Oh, yeah. They're on the run big time.
I have a question about something we learned, because I don't know when this happens in the episode, so I'm going to say it now. There's a moment where someone in this episode mentions something about the Mandalorian, and the way the line said, I'm telling you, I think it goes back to the crazy Jesse Theory 101.
Are you talking about how Werner Herzog, at the end of his little angry rant, is like, it's easier to find, like, Beskar than it is to find a real Mandalorian? Implying that because the Mandalorian asked the question, he's not a real Mandalorian?
Something like that, yeah.
The reason he's not a Mandalorian is not that. The reason that they're not real Mandalorians, quote-unquote, is because these are basically the children of the Jedi. You know what I mean? You know, maybe this armorer is like somebody who survived or
right.
something, but everybody else
I understand,
is, yeah.
But that line was very, like, prophetic, and it had, like, an implication to it that I know it's, a villain saying it, so it doesn't matter all that much. But then we see the scene when his armor's being forged, where we get a flashback of his youth. His parents are clearly murdered, and the last shot we see is that droid pointing his gun at him. And I'm like, yo, what does any of this mean? So I'm very excited to see what that... I have no clue, but I'm excited to see where this goes.
But let's get into it. Let's get into it beat by beat real quick. So, baby's awake. He does the thing where he is like, I want to play with the ball. And he, like, unscrews the ball off the hyperspace lever thing. And the Mandalorian is like, no, dumbass. Give me that back, you stupid. Like you would with a dog. And then puts him back in his little egg. And
meanwhile, he gets a little transmission from Grief Karga.
Yeah, he's like, Mando!
I'm so happy!
I love that he calls him Mando.
I love that he says it boisterously.
Yeah. Oh, Mando! It's so good! I love it.
So he lands on the planet. He goes straight to the client. He goes past the tattletale droid.
There's like so many good alien... There's just like good-ass alien designs. They should show a lot of them.
They scan the baby while he's in there, and the baby's fine, and they're like excited to have the baby. He pulls out the Beskar steel, and I wanted to bring this up because this is like a fun Star Wars thing.
The Camtano.
There's this famous guy when Cloud City is evacuating under Imperial control. You get this quick scene of this guy who's like sprinting through the thing, and the only reason this guy has a name in the canon of Star Wars is because he's literally just, if you see him, he's just holding like a department store model ice cream maker.
And he's right. Right.
And he's just running with it, and he's like wearing like an orange jumpsuit, and nobody knows who the hell he is. But his name is like, what did you say his name is?
No, Camtano is the name of is what they call the device.
The thing is a Camtano, yeah. I forget what the guy's name is, but the thing is called the Camtano, and what it actually is, it turns out, is like a safe.
Portable safe.
Yeah, which is awesome. So that's a fun little long-term Star Wars nerdy thing. But he gets like, I would say 10 times as much or something Beskar that he did last time. A lot more.
Yeah, he got like one or two before, and he got a fat stack of them.
Yeah, he got two last time. This time he got like 20 or something. And he's like, "Wait, what are you gonna do with this thing though? What do you have any plan? Like, what's the deal?" And the client's like,
"I wouldn't tell you if I wanted to because it's against the rules."
He was like real disappointed.
Yeah, he was super upset about it, and he like threw him out because it's, you know, it's a sensitive thing.
Yeah, he's like, "The code says that once you deliver it, you forget it."
Yeah, like that's how all the bounty hunters are. That's like part of the job. It's very like John Wick vibes. Actually, this whole episode is very John Wick vibes. And basically, he takes the Beskar back to the armorer, and he's like, "Yo, I'm having some issues with my armor. It's lost its integrity. I need to like start over." And then she's like, "Yo," because we remember we were talking about the signets 2 weeks ago when she was talking about like, "Have you got your signet?"
Yeah, the thing that he bested is what his signet would be.
The Mudhorn.
She offers to make him a signet out of the Mudhorn, but he's like, "No, I didn't actually beat that thing. I had help from my enemy." And she was like, "What? You had help from your enemy?" And he was like, "The enemy didn't know they were my enemy at the time." And so you get this like sort of moment where you're like, "Aw, Mando, you're feeling bad about this, aren't you?"
What's curious, though, is when he says, "I'll have to start over again." Did anyone else read that as even the armor that he has now is part of like a sequence that I guess ends? It's almost like an MMO. Where his, like, armor progression...
He had tier one armor on. Yeah, no.
But yeah, him saying, like, "I have to start over" is almost like, is that part of it? You have to reset down to, like, a base level of armor and, like, work your way up?
I think typically it's just, like, as a Mandalorian, like, your armor is, like, part of your body, right? The starting over element is just that, like, once you put this armor on your body, it's there. And the only time that you would ever replace a piece of it is if it got so totaled that you're just never going to be able to use it again. So it's not so much, like, you're starting at base tier.
He maybe just means, like, you can't repair this. It needs to be rebuilt.
Yeah, it's like, I'm actually going to have to need a new piece of armor. No, I know normally I come in and we just kind of, like, upgrade it.
Yeah, all the mechanics are messed up. Yeah, it's what we got from when the Rhino hit him.
Yeah.
Mandalorian armor is essentially... Sabine's a great example of this, even though they do it to, like, the nth degree. But Mandalorian armor is who you are.
Yeah. So Paz Vizsla, who is, like, the, like, heavy class of Mandalorian, I guess.
We got a bunch of awesome alternate costumes for Boba Fett in this episode.
It gave me serious, like, ODST vibes.
Yeah. Yeah.
From Halo. Like, the like when you start to unlock the other Halo armors that, like, kind of look like Master Chief, but don't really.
Before we do anything, by the way, since we're talking about the Mandalorians, we should, for anyone who doesn't know, really quickly... talk about the Vizsla clan.
Yes.
If you're out there and you're like, why is this guy important? Why is that a name that they're talking about? The Vizslas are huge in the lore of Star Wars. They are the baddies.
They're like the Starks.
Yeah, they're the baddies for a while. They're the goodies for a while. More importantly, they are the clan where the one guy in the history of Mandalore and the universe or galaxy, they created the Darksaber. The Darksaber was for one of the Vizsla guys. Was given or had the Darksaber made by a Jedi. I think he was the only Mandalorian Jedi ever.
It's interesting that when we finally see footage, as she makes him this new armor and she's like, "Do you want the thing?" And he's like, "No." She's like, "Oh, then I'll make you some whistling birds," which are, you know, a weapon. And then you get this thing where she's like smelting the armor. And every time she does that, it seems like he kind of like flashes back on his life. He is always like, "Make sure you keep some of this shit because we need more foundlings, whatever, whatever." And I don't know where the foundlings are coming from. Like, are the Mandalorians fucking down?
They could, or they could just be, like, people that they've found
over the
course.
Do you have sex with your helmet on? But I'm just wondering, like, are foundlings Mandalorian children?
Yeah, or they could
No. I thought they were supposed to be...
orphans of Mandalore, some across the galaxy. The name like foundling feels like they were found. I don't know.
No, I think it has to do with, like, foundry, like a blacksmith. Like, they're, like, little armor babies.
Oh, I thought it was they were founding the next generation. Is what I assume.
There's literally three interpretations of this word that we all thought were different, but could all be correct.
They all kind of mean the same thing, but we all understand that they're like the babies that they see as the future. So he walks out, he's got this bomb-ass suit now, and he walks into the bar where...
He looks so good.
Where Greef Karga is, and everybody's like, "Chuba." And Greef's like, "Mando!" And he's like, "What are you doing?" And he's like, "You know, I'm here for my next job." And he's like, "Don't you want to get high, bitch? Don't you want to, like, go to a whorehouse where the Twi'leks are at?"
Twi'lek bath, yeah.
Yeah. And he's like, "No, okay, all right. And then he's like, "Why don't you just get high? And by the time you get out of hyperspace, you won't feel fucked up about that baby." And he's like, what are you going to do with the baby? And he's like, "I can't tell you. That's the whole thing, dumbass." And so he's like, "Everybody hates you here. you are the only guy who got any of money off this huge score except for me, who is now rich. He's like, you cannot ask people what they do with their bounties after you deliver them. You already commissioned the bounty. You already got paid, so you got to get the fuck out of here. So he takes the job. It's a calamari guy. I translated the Arbesh, by the way. It just says wanted. I thought it was going to be an Easter egg that it was Admiral Akbar's, like, shitty, like, Orange
they
County.
They said it's just like some rich kid's.
It's a like noble, a calamari noble son. And I was hoping it was Admiral Akbar, who's like got an OC rich boy kid. But it doesn't actually say who it is. It just gives you like a generic wanted message. Right. But he takes it. He goes back to his ship and he's about to leave. But then he sees that the ball is still off of the little control that he gave to the Yoda baby. And he's like, God damn it. And he like goes back to get the kid. He goes back and he sees the egg in the trash. And he's like, mother fucker. So he gets up on this building and he like
Metal Gear Solid's the.
So this gun, first of all, is like everything to this guy. It's like as good as a lightsaber, and it has like a scope that has like a microphone attachment on it.
Different like vision modes.
Yeah, he can see through the wall. He sees them talking about it, and they purposefully sort of like put static in there so you can't really understand it. But they have a conversation about who wants this baby,
yes,
what they
yes,
want from the
yes.
baby.
Yes.
And I haven't had the chance to like, you know, chop it up and look at it, but I'm sure somewhere there's that. Did either of you?
No, it's all garbled, but there clearly is a person. There's a he that wants the baby.
Somebody above
like,
him. Yeah.
Right. And so it could be Giancarlo Esposito, who is
Gus.
Gus.
Yeah.
Who has been shown. Like, it could be him. It probably is him.
I feel like in the trailer stuff.
Or it could be somebody bigger, somebody named.
I agree. I think it's that. Because in the trailer stuff, he seems like the gopher. Like, he seems like the person they send after the Mandalorian to get the baby. Grand Admiral Sloan, that story's never been resolved. She's out there. And I wouldn't put it past Disney being like, the main bad guy is this badass woman. And I'd be fine with that. I'd be like, ready to go. We need that story.
Well, where is Sloan?
Vanishes.
What happens to Sloan? She leaves the galaxy?
Sloan literally takes the Imperial Force. Because Gallius Rax is like, yo, there's this place out there in the unknown regions. We're gathering our forces. Go there. And she...
And we're to assume that that's the
first
order,
she takes the kids. She takes General Hux's dad. And they all go out there. Randall. And she's building... Yeah, she's building the first order. And then she as a character vanishes and has never been addressed since.
Maybe... Okay, how about this then? How about this for a theory? Say Snoke is the new emperor, for example, of the first order. And that Snoke is the one who's running the... machinations in the outer regions, right? Because we don't when we check out with the Empire at the end of the Empire, Sloane is like an Imperial officer who's leaving to and she's in charge. And what
right.
we know
with the last
which is
Super
by,
Star Destroyer and all that.
But what,
yeah.
but what we know by just power of deduction is that somewhere in there Sloane gets ousted and Snoke takes control of this force and then returns as the First Order. Which we learn about even more in that Leia book because there's like that weird sort of like terrorist group that like is the First Order kind of.
Yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
And so to me, I'm wondering if maybe like what's happening here is that we're seeing the machinations of the new leader of the First Order who is like now starting to do, you know how the Palpatine has his like little weird like plans and shit that he's doing all the time?
Oh, he's a schemer.
I'm wondering if this is like Snoke's that.
Maybe. It would be nice if this was its own thing though and... Yeah, I guess you can't really separate the two.
The Empire is in the mix here somehow.
What I would like and what I'm hoping is that this is the non-First Order-y side. Those people went off with what's-her-face and Sloan and are off doing their own thing, and this is just the leftovers fighting for something.
Could be.
Here's all I'll say. In Rebels, there's a character that I very highly think that potentially... could be the Imperial threat that is around, that is not the Emperor, that is not any of that. And I will leave it at that because timeline, it checks out.
And his name is Grand Admiral Thrawn.
And I'm just saying, what if that's it?
When they were saying he, and before any of my logic centers kicked in, I was like, what if we're going to see Grand Admiral Thrawn? This would be perfect. Except that, like, I got to remember that this version of Grand Admiral Thrawn is, like, not a bad guy.
He's like a folk hero.
Well, here's the thing. We haven't read the other two books.
That's true. That's
right.
True.
There's,
we don't know what happens.
And the version of him in Rebels so far both lines up with and like f- feels a little different than the book version. Like, on paper, it kind of all kind of works. But he has just, because he's the villain of a kid's show, a different demeanor than, like, his, at least what I read from the book. But his motivations and actions are such that to have him really be an antagonist in this new show after the Empire's dead, I don't know if it would work, but I still have more books to read and more Rebels to watch. Like, we're 3 episodes in, and because of the slow pace, which I love, I feel like this first season is going to be like Castlevania's first season, where it's like a primer, or it's like it'll tease a bunch of stuff, but yeah, I don't think right. that we're going to see any of that stuff till season 2 or beyond.
Yeah, and honestly, more realistically, your boy's going to be the villain of this season anyway, the big villain of the season anyway. Giancarlo Esposito.
Yeah.
He's like names, you know this, right?
Right.
You know, he's Moff Gideon, who is a former governor under the Empire, whose life changed after the Rebels destroyed the second Death Star.
I feel like this character, this Moff's, you know, can be governors, and governors, if this is a Wild West tale, he's like the corrupt mayor. And at the end of the Wild West tale, after there's like the crazy shootout, the corrupt mayor always gets his. So I feel like he's not making it out of this season. He's the baddie for this season who gets, you know, good, bad, and uglied at the end.
Yeah, I mean, I'm that's what I'm hoping. I mean, I'm hoping that this show in general stays pretty street level, but I think, like, you know, they would be doing sort of like a disservice to the material if they didn't at least like slot it into the galaxy somewhere, like set it amongst Disney's some events. But I don't necessarily think that the Mandalorian needs to be at the center of them. You know, like, if he's only pulled into this because there's this Yoda baby, and then all he cares about is the Yoda baby, you know, that's fine. If that's as close as he gets to the story, that would be fine with me. I just am interested to know what that story is, because there are things about the Star Wars timeline that we don't know yet. And this is the first time we've ever even seen this time period in the timeline. So for me, it's less about like how it relates to the Mandalorian directly, and more about just like how it relates to like other historical events in this fake timeline. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Disney has definitely made it their purpose and goal to make everything connected. So I think us sitting here talking, we're trying to figure out how the hell they're going to pull that off, because there's a lot of inconsistencies and things that don't make sense right away. But maybe we just don't have the information.
So. It's also wild to me that there's one more episode of Mandalorian after Rise of Skywalker comes out.
Right.
That seems like a deliberate decision, but I don't know. So, real quick, the Mandalorian catches these guys on the thing. He, like, gets heat vision of them. He puts, like, a thing on the wall. He blows his way in. He's basically Batmans his way through this place, just, like, taking every dude out. They corner him, and, of course, it calls back to the whistling birds from earlier that he made. He shoots him out. It's, like, little homing rocket missile things that kill all the stormtroopers. It's fucking awesome. He gets the baby out of this little chair. The doctor, like...
He sets a dude on fire. It's incredible.
Yeah, he burns a stormtrooper inside his armor, and you can hear that motherfucker cooking after he walks away.
Oh, man.
And Baby Yoda's like, ooh!
Yeah, the doctor is like really scared of the Mando, but the doctor's also like,
should be.
He was like, I am the only reason this baby's alive. Please don't kill me. Everybody wants to kill this thing. Please, I just need it for this one thing. Lada yada yada, whatever. He gets out. They break out. They're about to get away. Turns out every bounty hunter in town is waiting for him, including Grief.
This is like the straight up John Wick scene where it's like everyone around him.
They're starting
is also
to get the text, the text updates. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Grief's there and he's like, Mando! This is bullshit! And then he's like, fuck you. And he shoots at him, and it's just a shootout. He jumps into this cart with the baby. He actually does finally trust a droid to drive him around, because he, like, hijacks a
for
droid
two
car.
Seconds.
Yeah. He shoots everybody. He's, like, blowing people away with his disintegrator. He's starting to get cornered. Everything's going wrong. And then all of a sudden, bazinga, here comes every single Mandalorian in the show. It's an easy win. He gets out. He gets away. He screws the little ball off. Oh, but before he gets away, he gets confronted one last time by Grief Karga, who has, like, snuck aboard his ship. And he's like, this is where the road ends, Mando. And Mando's like, go fuck yourself. And he, like, shoots his little grappling hook to turn on the carbonite gas. And then he uses the gas as, like, a smoke screen to, like, line up a shot to just, like, pop Grief Karga right in the chest.
But in very Western style, the Beskar that he got from earlier is what saves him.
Yeah,
it's like his Bible in his pocket.
Like a Bible in the pocket kind of vibe.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then he flies away. He gives him the little baby ball thing from the handle. He gives it to Baby Yoda. And now he's like, now I'm your actual dad. So, the end.
It's so good. Yeah, the back half is like all action, but it's like wonderfully paced. Deborah Chow, who directed this episode, is directing the Obi-Wan, the show.
I also perceived one of the last shots of the show as an actual tribute to Iron Man. When Paz Vista like flies up to his window as he's leaving the planet and gives
Rocketeer
him a salute.
Style. Yeah.
It literally reminds me of the Iron Patriot from Iron Man 3 when he's like flying next to the Air Force One. It's like, yeah. It gives me that same vibe, and knowing that it was Jon Favreau in there and that he's Disney and that he's like flying a jetpack, it's like screaming Iron Man to me. It doesn't matter whether it is or not, but it just gave me this Iron Man vibe. And then yeah. Mando and then says something along like, I gotta get me one of these. And then the end.
And he will.
I hope.
We've seen the trailer. Have you not seen the trailers?
No, I've been trying to avoid them because I don't want small plot elements to be spoiled for me as I go.
You didn't watch the trailers before the show came out?
I watched the first trailer because I didn't know what it was, and then that's it.
Oh, well, then he doesn't get one.
It doesn't matter. I can figure figure it out.
No, he doesn't get one. Seriously.
Oh, okay, good. Good. Yeah. I'll take that to heart. That's it. That's the end of the... It's the end of the show.
All right. Well, a new episode is this Friday. We're all very excited to see what happens next. I believe this is the episode with actual rebels in it.
The next Ooh. One?
So this should be fun.
Yeah, and it's directed by Bryce Dallas Howard, which is exciting.
And we'll meet, all right. What's her face? Kara...
Zarya?
Her name yet. No, the...
From Overwatch?
Cara Dune?
Yeah, Cara Dune.
Yeah, a great Star Wars name. All right, so we'll see what this next episode's about. I imagine it's going to be, again, very Western-themed. Probably a spoof, like many of these other ones have been, of some Western trope. And so we'll see exactly what it is, but I'm very, very excited. But that's it for us. Thank you so much. We'll see you guys next time with some more Star Wars Mandalore discussion. Bye, everybody.
And remember, keep your friends close. And let your droid taxis take the hits for you.
Oh, thank
you. You know, where's the payoff?
Bring the strippers and boobs!
We do occasionally talk about video games.
Bring the strippers and boobs!
Out of that time of video games.
Bring the strippers and boobs!
Oh, thank God, I don't need pants now.
Hey, JC, what are you doing?
Not much. Making a fortune.
It's a professional broadcast.
Yeah, now sing music.
It's a professional broadcast.
Bring the strippers and boobs.
It's a professional broadcast.
Now here to ask and answer one simple question.
It's a professional broadcast.
You got it.